Doctor Who, The Crotons, by Robert Holmes, Episode 1. A dignified man in his 50s stands waiting before a great crystalline wall. At its centre, a short ramp leads up to a closed hexagonal doorway. The construction is at odds with the roughly hewn stonework that forms the rest of the subterranean chamber, the learning hall of the Gons. A small access hatch opens. Reaching inside, the man, Selris, removes a scroll, then turns to face a large gathering of expectant youths, all dressed in simple overalls.
Class 3196 in the first grade. The names of the two selected candidates are male, Abugon.
Well-wishing friends cluster about the proud student.
The second name is female, Varnagon.
The girls' friends offer their congratulations, all bar one.
No!
The dissenter, Thara, pushes through the crowd towards Varna. Selris shoots him a reproving look.
Abugond and Vanagond, alone of your generation, you have been chosen to receive the highest honor that can befall a god. You are now the companions of the Crotons. Our warmest, our most sincere congratulations to you both. You will now step forward for the investiture of your robes of honor. Elect.
He nods towards a thick-set man who solemnly helps the waiting Abu into a long, shimmering cloak and places a large metal medallion about his neck. Thara, meanwhile, is remonstrating with Varna.
Please, Thara!
You can't go. I won't let you go.
I must.
Look, Varna, we can run away. There's still time.
You know that's not possible. We must always obey.
Why?
Because, my son, it is the law of the Crotons.
All eyes turn to the doorway. As it opens upwards, its surface throbs with an inner light. Abu steps into the darkness beyond, and the doorway slides shut. Amidst a black, poison landscape of rocks and the occasional petrified tree stump, the blue police box shape of the TARDIS takes form. The door opens, and Jamie, Zoe, and the Doctor file out.
Lovely, lovely, lovely. Oh, bad eggs. Let's try somewhere else.
Now, wait a minute. Where are we?
Oh, you don't expect him to know, do you? Well, let's explore, shall we?
Your umbrella.
He has twin sons. It's bound to be hot.
Oh. I don't think I like it here. Looks dead.
Oh, it smells dead.
Sulfur, isn't it? It could be poisonous.
No. The instruments in the TARDIS would have told us. No, it's a mixture of ozone and sulfur. Very bracing.
Holding his umbrella like a parasol, the Doctor sets off enthusiastically across the desolate scenery, humming as he goes. Zoe and Jamie look at each other and follow reluctantly. The Doctor's attention is taken by something at his feet. He stoops and picks up a large flake of mineral.
Oh, what's that? It's fascinating structures. Magnesium silicate, eh?
He means mica.
Stuffing the mica into his pocket, the Doctor leads the way up a small rise.
Dead, is it?
He points into the valley below.
It's a city.
Yes, a fascinating architecture. It's more typical of a low-gravity planet, and yet I think this is quite normal, yes.
Inca, perhaps?
Yes, possibly. Come on, let's see what he's up to. Careful.
They follow Jamie down the hillside towards a gigantic dome-shaped structure at the edge of the city.
Doctor, down here!
Partially buried within the hillside itself, the dome is constructed from a honeycomb of crystal. As the trio draws closer, they spot a hexagonal doorway set atop a metal ramp. Once smooth and silver, time and neglect have dulled the surface to a resemblance of granite.
What is it?
Don't know. There's a ramp here.
Yes, and there's a door as well. Is it a wall?
I hardly think so, Zoe. Ooh, that smells a lot stronger around here.
The Doctor is inspecting the doorway.
Oh, this is interesting.
What, Doctor?
Oh, metal, isn't it?
What, covered in moss and lichen?
Well, metal? Would you say so? I think we better get away from here.
What?
Come along.
But why?
Well, this isn't a building. This is a machine. Come along.
Doctor, it's open! Come on, take behind the rocks!
They dive for cover as the doorway slides upwards. A figure shambles into view. It is Abu, clutching at his head, the once alert and confident youngster now has the appearance of a slack-jawed simpleton. As Abu stumbles on oblivious, two slender pipes extend from panels at either side of the doorway. Twin jets of fluid spurt forth, and Abu falls to the ground, writhing in agony as white clouds of vapour steam from his rapidly dissolving body. The time travellers emerge from hiding. Horror-struck, they regard the corroded metal medallion lying in the earth at the base of the ramp. All that remains of the hapless youth.
What happened to him?
I don't know, Jamie. Come on, let's get away from here.
As Elik helps Varna into her silver robe, Thara appeals to his father.
Father, can't you give the order she doesn't have to go? You're our leader.
But the Crotons have chosen Varna. It is a great honor.
Honor? Why do we take their orders?
Varna.
Thara grabs Varna, his other hand fingering the small stone axe at his belt.
We don't even know if they exist.
You can't say things like that.
Get out of the way.
She's not going into that machine.
She has to go in. No one defies the Crotons.
All right! And don't be so stupid.
Thara!
Disarm him.
Thara raises his axe.
Keep back!
As Thara's standoff with Elik's men continues, the doctor's party creeps down the steps at the rear of the hall.
Oh, well, I hope they're friendly.
Just leave this to me, Zoe.
Smiling benignly, he holds out his hands in greeting to the small group of pikemen guarding the entrance.
We are friends. It's all right. Now, don't be afraid.
I have trouble.
Who are you?
Axus, the pikeman's leader, approaches.
One of your people has been...
You're strangers. Where are you from?
Well, if we told you, it wouldn't mean anything.
Answer me. Where are you from?
There's no time for explanations. As I say, one of your
they're
people
They're not
has
guns.
Been...
They're clothes, the way they're dressed.
Look... We are friendly.
Look, are you going to let us pass
Doctor,
or not?
Look.
At the other end of the hall...
Do something about him. He's your son.
I'm warning you. One step nearer.
Thara, will you be reasonable? The Crotons have sent for Varna.
She's not going. Nobody comes back from there.
Let me go, Thara. Please. I don't want them to hurt you.
Outnumbered by pikemen, Thara tosses his axe away. Celris motions everyone back. Squeezing her lover's hand in farewell, Varna crosses over to Elik at the foot of the ramp. Thara looks on numbly as Elik places the metal medallion around Varna's neck.
A bit of sense. Just in time.
That doorway, it's like the other one.
And she's wearing a cloak just like that chap we saw killed.
Is she being sacrificed?
Oh, I don't think so, Dorazoe. They're too civilized for that.
Can we not stop them?
Well, we can try. Just a minute. Wait!
They're interrupting the ceremony. Take them!
No, just... you wouldn't be so tough without these guards around you.
Axus signals his men.
Get back. I accept your challenge.
Oh, you do you? Well, that's just fine with me, then.
Now, Jamie, don't be so rash.
Don't worry, Doctor. I'll see to this lad. No, I'll not be needing that, thank you.
Oh, Jamie, watch out!
Having declined an axe from one of the gons, Jamie crouches low like a wrestler. Axus lunges at him with his axe, but Jamie anticipates the attack and sidesteps. Arms outstretched, the two circle each other warily. As Axus swings his weapon upwards for another blow, Jamie seizes him by the wrists. They grapple. Little by little, Jamie painfully wrenches his opponent's axe arm backwards. At last, the weapon clatters to the ground, followed by its winded owner.
Doctor, look, the girl!
Varna has climbed the ramp and is waiting at the entrance, which begins to slide upwards. She exchanges one last wistful look with Thara and steps inside. The door slides down, and she is gone. Purposefully, Celris strides towards the back of the hall.
What is happening? Who are these people?
That is the very question I was going to ask you. What is happening here? Where has that girl gone?
Elik, they forced their way through her.
Who are you?
There is no time to explain. Look, you wouldn't believe us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.